Pressure. We all feel it, especially at this point in the semester when one realizes perhaps they've made a wrong decision with their life goal. I'm the Great Orbax. We're here today with Dr. Mike Massa to discuss a different kind of pressure, hydrostatic pressure. Dr. Massa?
Okay. Thanks for that. So we've been looking at pressure in liquids. One thing we can certainly all experience is that when you go further down in a body of water, say a swimming pool or a toilet, the pressure increases with depth. So I want to take a look at that and just see how much the pressure will increase based on how further down we go.
Well, a good place to start is to remember what our definition for pressure actually is. Pressure is equal to an amount of force divided by a cross-sectional area, right? The actual area that that force acts upon.
So let's take a look at two points, point one and point two. We know that the pressure at point two is going to be greater than point one by some amount.
I mean, you experience that even in the most basic application of going into a swimming pool.
Right.
You feel more pressure, more force pushing down on you.
Yeah. Now, the reason for that is because, well, really at the bottom of the pool, there's extra weight of water on you. So the best way to see that is to look at a column of water, a plug of water here of, say, some height H that is the difference in height between points one and point two. Let's draw a free body diagram of this because we're going to assume there's no flow, so the net force here acting on that body of water is going to be zero.
And if we're defining this actual plug, looking at this volume of water, this gives us a definition of what the volume actually is. The volume of water that we're looking at is this cross-sectional area multiplied by the height. We can discuss this actual chunk of water itself.
Perfect. Okay, well, the force is acting on here. We've got water pushing up from below, exerting an upward pressure. Let's call that a force F2. We've got a downward force, F1, from the water above pushing down.
And you've actually got the force of gravity that's acting as well, right, at the center point. And that's just equal to mg.
All right. So the sum of the forces are zero. We've got F2 pushing upwards, F1 pushing downwards, and mg pushing downwards as well.
Now, we've already defined the pressure as being the force per area. And so what that means is that we can also discuss the force as being equal to the pressure times the cross-sectional area.
So then I'm going to write that force F2 as P2 times A, P1 times A for the force at the top.
And that gives us an expression for that force of gravity, mg, to work on now. So we know we have mass, we know we have multiplied by gravity, we have some kind of volume here, and we know that the density of that water is equal to the mass divided by the volume, or that the mass is equal to the density times the volume.
Okay, and let's actually write the volume as A times H. So we go from mg to rho times the volume, which is A times H, and then let's not forget the G on the end. And those two forces are
zero. It's equal to zero. So right away you could divide the whole thing by A.
Right.
Get rid of those cross-sectional areas.
Okay.
And that allows us to now rewrite the change in pressure, or P2 minus P1.
Okay. Let me write that as P2 minus P1. We often talk about that as a change in pressure. Let me call that delta P.
And the difference between here and here.
Right. And I'll bring this to the other side of the equation. So we've got rho. We've got g, the acceleration due to gravity, and h. So we see that P2 is greater than P1 by a certain amount that's based on how further down you are in the liquid, what the density of the liquid is, and the g comes about because it really is just the force of gravity that ramps that pressure up.
Wow,